Welcome, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
Several weeks ago, South Korea had the most COVID-19 patients of any country outside of China. And the country had the same number as we did here in the United States.
Today, South Korea has had 300 COVID-19 deaths, and the U.S. has had over 75,000. So what did South Korea do to stop the advancement of the virus? William Gallo, Seoul Bureau Chief of Voice of America, joins us to answer the question. Thank you for joining us, William. First,
thanks for having me.
Thank you. First, how are you doing?
Well, things are pretty well here in South Korea. I mean, as you mentioned, we were one of the first countries to sort of get hit by the coronavirus, and it looked really bad for about a month. And then you started to see a very drastic turnaround. Life here is almost normal. I mean, at certain night spots and things, you now see people hanging out in groups, hanging out with their friends after work. Most businesses have reopened. There is sporting events, although without fans. So with some big exceptions, life is something like normal here in South Korea right now.
So what did South Korea do to halt the spread of the coronavirus?
I think maybe the most important thing was that they tested a lot of people right away. But that is only part of the story. I think that South Korea initially got a lot of attention because of the number of tests it did. And part of the reason they were able to do so many tests is because they actually did a lot of regulatory reform to sort of like fast track the process by which a coronavirus test could actually be approved and get to market. So there was some forethought for that sort of thing because they had dealt before with past outbreaks such as Middle East respiratory syndrome and things like that. The other thing that they did, and this is crucial, I would say it's at least half of the reason why they have succeeded. In addition to testing, they were able to do contact tracing through digital surveillance of people's phones. This is a very connected society. Even older people have smartphones. Everyone is on a smartphone. And what South Korea did was they reformed the laws, which allowed health authorities to be able to have access to this data, to then be able to actually find where infected patients have been and to isolate people, to test them. They knew where to look, basically.
What I understand, too, is one of the places they looked was a particular religious denomination.
Yes. So essentially what happened was South Korea had seen for weeks just a couple dozen cases. And then there was a patient, I believe it was patient 31, went to this religious group. This was sort of a fringe religious group in South Korea, of which there are very many. It had some unique features in that there's a lot of physical contact in the service. People would sit on the floor and they were huddled together. And it was sort of like not a great situation for a virus. It was easily spread in this setting is what I'm trying to say. So what happened was thousands and thousands of people got infected as a result of this one person going to this church, which complicated the situation, obviously, for South Korea, but it also made it a little bit easier in that the authorities here in South Korea just did a massive effort to find every member of this group that they could and test them. And the cluster infection was largely contained because they were able to find members of that group and actually isolate them, test them, and things like that.
So was South Korea kind of taking a page out of the SARS and H1N1 playbook and the other viruses they've experienced in past?
Yes, they were ready for it. And I would say it's the one thing that has sort of made South Korea's response different from other examples. They had planned for this. I mean, they knew what they were doing in a way that I don't really sense that other countries have really thought through some of the trade-offs, for instance. The one thing that really strikes me is in other countries, we've seen these mass lockdowns, right? People just not able to leave their homes, businesses shut down, things like this. We never really saw that in South Korea. Instead, what you had was this surveillance-based contact tracing, this digital surveillance-based contact tracing, which was very intrusive in a way, right? I mean, you are violating someone's privacy by being able to look at whatever they do on their phone, essentially, right? But someone had thought of that beforehand to basically calculate, okay, we're taking away a bit of privacy, but we're protecting someone's ability to go out and go shopping, to go to church, to be able to keep their jobs. The economy never shut down. So things like that, there was a calculation made beforehand. And I'm very impressed at actually how they have been able to keep even more essential freedoms, I think, during this really challenging time.
Now, William, speaking of that, why does it appear that the South Korean populace was more amenable to this intrusion, albeit it was for public health reasons?
Right. It's a major question. I think everybody sort of thinks about this issue, gets to that point. And one of the answers that you see talked about is that South Koreans or Asians are more collective in nature and things like that. I don't think that's the case. I really don't think that this answer does very well in South Korea, only because this is a place where there are constant protests. I have never been in a city with more anti-government protests and just more protests in general. Yeah. In fact, something like every living former South Korean president spent some time in jail. This is not exactly a passive population that just is okay with anything the government does. However, this current government, there is a great deal of trust, I think, in this current government to be able to be competent enough to address situations like this. And on top of that, I believe that South Korean people think that if something is not working, it can be fixed. And I know I'm saying big things and it might sound a little Pollyanna-ish, but there is a great trust in the ability of the people to go out on the streets and demand change if a public service is not working. And so I think that people here are happy with the way the government has responded. And if they aren't, then they'll go out and protest and cause change.
Now, how are marginalized communities being dealt with in South Korea through this?
That is a little bit harder because a lot of these communities are more invisible, right? Just by the nature, I think, of migrant workers and things like that. We haven't heard so many horrible stories that you might expect. The government here has made an attempt to basically take care of the most marginalized members of society, because I think there is, with this particular outbreak, especially if you're not dealing with it in a holistic way, then any part of it can come back and bite you, right? So I think there is concern, but so far the worst fears have not been realized, regarding migrant communities and more marginalized communities here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you mentioned earlier that the economy wasn't really impacted negatively like it has been here in the United States, in South Korea, but are there aspects of the economy that have been affected by this virus?
So I would say probably the biggest part of the economy which has been impacted was the small businesses, and maybe that's true everywhere, but in South Korea in particular, there is a lot of delivery service. I mean, people get, food delivered and groceries delivered on a much wider scale than in the United States. So big companies, I think, had the means to be able to switch to more of a delivery-based kind of system, whereas the smaller businesses and mom and pop shops and things like that, they just didn't. And so they were more reliant on loans from the government, and there have been efforts like that. But there is a lot of suffering here still. I mean, I don't mean to suggest that South Korea has been totally immune. I read a stat, something like 40% of workers have seen a reduction in wages. So it's not as if South Korea hasn't been hit by this, but they've definitely avoided the worst compared to other countries.
Now, in sectors such as tourism, hospitality, airlines, and so forth, have South Koreans been impacted the way we have in the United States, with not being able to go to these places because of restrictions, or just this sense that it's not really safe or they're not comfortable traveling and gathering in large groups?
Right. Well, you've seen very little travel here over the last couple months, and that hasn't really been that much different than any other country. What South Korea has done is impose very, very strict quarantines on international arrivals, something like a 2-week mandatory quarantine. It varies whether or not you actually get a coronavirus test upon arrival, but most people, I believe, now do get mandatory tests. They have to undergo a 2-week quarantine. So, you know, that doesn't mean that people can't come here, but even for like business, business people and tourists, things like that, you don't want to really have a 2-week quarantine. So definitely tourism has been impacted, but we just saw a 5-day holiday period here in South Korea, where there usually is a lot of travel. And what happened this time was South Koreans just traveled domestically a lot. So some of that activity actually is picking up here in South Korea over the last few weeks.
Good deal. I was thinking, you know, Americans only get about 2 weeks holiday anyway, so they'd be stuck in quarantine.
Yeah, I know. It's sad.
Okay. As we wrap up here, William, once this is over, I guess, in many ways, life is getting back to normal in South Korea. Do you plan to do something special or go somewhere that you haven't been able to go during the past few weeks?
So one of the best perks of my job here is that I actually do get to do a bit of travel. I'm the sole bureau chief, but actually it's like a regional correspondent. So it's quite fun to be able to travel to places like Taiwan or Hong Kong or Indonesia. You never know where you get to sort of go next. It just sort of depends on where the news takes you. And it's not exactly a sacrifice. I understand that. I'm not complaining about it, but I am very much looking forward to being able to travel again. I don't know where that will be. However, I feel very, very fortunate, extremely fortunate to have been in South Korea at this time, especially given that they've been able to, you know, contain this coronavirus so successfully. In fact, it feels very weird talking to my family and stuff that are still dealing with this in the United States and seeing sort of the contrast and the responses there.
Well, William, thank you so much for joining us. Be safe. And to our audience, just keep smiling.